Hello, my name is Jacob, and I am a Norse pagan. And it is finally time to talk about the most requested video I've had in the last 18 months. So today, on this beautiful winter day, I'm going to be talking about oath rings. So first, let's talk about why I haven't talked about oath rings on this channel until now. It's taken me a long time, and there's actually not a lot of good sources out there and barely any videos about oath rings, and yet they're one of the most popular things you'll see next to the Mjolnir as something people buy when they first get into Norse paganism. And that's kind of why I've kind of stayed away from it, because they are very popular and I don't want to tell anyone they're wrong by wearing them, and they're not necessarily wrong. I mean, shoot, I wear one. It's just with everything we're discovering in this faith, and what I'm discovering in this faith, is that there is just inconsistencies in what we've been told, but also the truth of what we actually know is so minimal, it's hard to say for sure if these have any true meaning. With most videos, I'm going to start with the facts. Did our pre-Christian Scandinavian Germanic ancestors use oath rings? To what extent do they use them? Do we have any proof that they used them? And then after that, we'll move into what does this mean today? What is the history of an oath ring today in our modern use? And then of course, at the end of the video, we'll cover my opinions, what I've experienced with them, and what I think they represent now. So the history of the oath ring. So the oath rings have been discovered to an extent. From what research I have done, we have found something that would be an oath ring. It's just, we can't necessarily say they are. The big difference here is because they are so old. They are from the late Bronze Age, from around 1700 to 500 BCE. So these are very old objects. They are very simple design, and we have found a few of them, but not a lot of them, and it's not very widespread. You know, these were found in Denmark. We haven't found a collection in Sweden. We haven't found a collection in Norway. So it's very hard to say definitively if these are oath rings. Now, if we didn't have this next piece of information, we might not even think that oath rings existed, and they may not exist today, because they are not mentioned a lot in the Eddic stories, especially not the Poetic Edda or the Prose Edda. They are, however, mentioned in the Icelandic sagas. One such story, which, as always, I'm a filthy American here and I do not pronounce things right, so I do apologize, so I'll just put it on the screen, but I believe it's Lammabok, is a story within the Icelandic sagas that talks about a 2-ounce ring that is kept within the temple. This ring was meant to be worn by the Gothi and or the chieftain of that particular region during moot and or law-speaking events. It was then treated very similar to how our modern legal system treats oaths. So you swear an oath to tell the truth, nothing but the truth, etc. Obviously, it's not exactly that, but it's very similar. Essentially, you're just swearing on your oath ring that you are going to tell the events exactly as they happened. And so, through this story, and this story was written in the 9th century, and so this is much later than these late Bronze Age oath rings that we have found. And so these two stories combined, it's like, oh, maybe this is the oath ring that they were talking about. And, you know, again, it's just so hard to say if those two things were actually connected, and if they are, how widespread they were. You know, the late Bronze Age period that it talks about between 1700 and 500 BCE, that's a long window for these things to change, to go out of practice, to go back into practice, to what extent they were practiced. The fact that we haven't found very many of them shows that maybe there wasn't that widespread use of them. So it's really hard to say historically if these were used widespread in the pre-Christian Scandinavian and Germanic societies. So let's go ahead and move down the trail, and I'm going to talk about the modern use of these, at least in media and as a modern religious instrument. I should also say on the way to our next destination here that I'm only referring to the historical evidence of them being oath rings. There is a lot of evidence within sagas and stories that talk about arm rings being a reward to loyal men of a king or jarl. So arm rings were used. We know they were gifts. We just don't know if they themselves were like these sacred objects of swearing these this very sacred oaths on. Most of the evidence from these oaths come from the Icelandic sagas. So yes, arm rings did exist, arm rings were used. It's just the actual use of them has varied between story and story, and as always, I believe they vary from region to region. So when looking at the modern usage of the Oath Ring, I do want to still start with Iceland and Ásatrú revivalization there, because these are a very prominent piece within a lot of their ceremonies, and you can find a lot of evidence of this online. You can see pictures of their Oath Rings. Now, from what I've been able to find of the actual modern Icelandic Ásatrú use, is that they are actually quite a lot bigger, and the wearing of a singular Oath Ring around the arm or bicep is not as common, and they typically just use the very large form of them for ceremonial purposes. Now, let's get to the elephant in the room. The reason I've avoided this video for so long, and a reason that I find this such a tricky subject, is because of our good old friend, the Vikings TV show. In episode 1, they have Oath Rings very prominently featured as Björn and Ragnar travel to Kattegat for the Oath Ring ceremony, where Björn becomes a man and swears the oath to the king, where you put the salt in the earth on the sword. I mean, this is all well and fine. It was a really cool ceremony. It was cool to get to see it. But at the same time, I don't believe this is, from what I can find, this wasn't based on anything. This was kind of just their own thing they added to this. And again, this could have been done by a Jarl or a king at some point within the Scandinavian or Germanic worlds, but we don't really have proof that this was something they did. Like I just said, the giving of an oath ring as a reward or a symbol of fealty may have been something, as we can see in other sagas, but like as widespread as this is as a child becoming a man to serve the king, we can't really say for sure. The main problem here that I'm trying to get to is that it was in episode 1. So if anyone has watched anything about Vikings, they've probably seen episode 1 of the Vikings TV show. And so they've probably seen the Oath Ring. And so I believe that is why they have become so popular, at least the arm-sized ones. I mean, you can find thousands of these Oath Rings online, from varying prices from $10 all the way up to $300, $400, $500, as they're made from better and better quality material. But at the end of the day, we cannot escape the fact that these Oath Rings have become popular. I don't know many people, at least within my inner circle, that do not have an Oath Ring of some kind. But the big question we have to answer is, are they important? Are they sacred? Or are they really just a decorative jewelry? Because for me, they look cool, and that's why a lot of people get them that aren't even into paganism or Ásatrú or heathenry. They just get them because they look cool or because they've seen the Vikings TV show. So to me, what is an Oath Ring? What have they become in our modern world? As I always say, this is our modern saga. This religion is constantly changing. We are informed by the past, and we can take things from the past and let them inform us on how we should do things now. But this religion has evolved, whether some people want to accept it or not. So are Oath Rings now an important thing? And I believe so, yes. There is one thing I want to clear up, though. Because of their importance, because of this high pedestal they're put on, I believe that a lot of people subconsciously think that an Oath Ring is a form of baptism. Now, you might think that's crazy, but I've seen it before. I have witnessed it in countless messages with people where they think, oh, I'm a Norse pagan now, I need to get an Oath Ring, and I need to swear an oath. Looking into the past, we can tell that oaths were very important to the pre-Christian Scandinavian and Germanic ancestors. And so looking into now, oaths are just as important, but I believe this whole Oath Ring thing has become too connected. We need to separate them a little bit. You can swear an oath without an Oath Ring, and you can wear an Oath Ring without having an oath. It's they're not so interwoven as we have made them. As far as the matron and patron thing, this is a very modern interpretation of how we interact with these deities. Now, I would say I have a patron deity, as an Odin. If you want to label it as that, it's just I typically work with Odin more, and I do have an oath to Odin. But it might surprise you that my oath to Odin is not on this Oath Ring. My oath to Odin is actually within this tattoo. When I got this tattoo was when I decided that I was going to go down this path more fully and commit to working on this YouTube, working in, on the wisdom of Odin. And so this is actually my oath. That was the symbol for me. So I think if you swear an oath, it can be into anything. It can be out in the air. But the more you put into it, the more serious I think it'll be taken. But also, I think the more serious the consequences if you do not follow through. So do you need an Oath Ring to swear an oath? No. Do you need an Oath Ring to be a Norse pagan? No, you don't even need a Mjolnir to be a Norse pagan if you don't want. They are just objects that help us connect to our faith on a daily basis. I wear my Oath Ring every day, and I have sworn oaths on this. I have, I believe, 5 other oaths besides my Odin one, and I will follow them to the day I die or until the day they are complete because they are important to me. But this has just become an object of that. It is not the oaths themselves. It is just something that I wear to remind me of those oaths. Now, as a little bit of a bonus, I guess, What about oath rings in a ritual context? You know, I get this question all the time, and that is, these oath rings, do we need a ritual if we do swear an oath onto them? And you have seen oath ring videos as far as like people swearing public oaths within my own videos. And this is something I'm actually taking a step away from. So let's get down to the last subject. I'm gonna head up this trail here and we'll go ahead and close out this video. So as far as an oath ring ceremony, this is a suggestion. I don't have anything to really inform you of what a proper oath ring ceremony should be, just because we don't have any evidence. You might find some others online people have conducted, but nothing is definitive. So if you do want to swear an oath onto an oath ring, and keep in mind, when I say swear an oath, like if you are swearing an oath to a deity, you better be ready, because this is going to be a commitment for the rest of your life. And I think that's something that has scared me from making this video, is a lot of people attached to this so early into their journey. It took me 4 years to swear my first oath, and that was even on this tattoo. It wasn't on this oath ring. While I have sworn oaths on this oath ring now, it's nothing too formal. I mean, I have simply, I don't even think I can share one of them. They just feel so sacred to me. And that's the other thing, is in the past, I have had oath ring ceremonies as part of my gathering videos. But keep in mind, these have never been something that I myself have performed. It's something that other people have wanted to perform. And while I'm still new in this path, especially in the gathering path, I'm like, oh, well, yeah, if you want to do that, that sounds great. But the more I have witnessed these public oath ring ceremonies, the more I realize that it is not the direction we need to go in. When you begin this path, you don't have to swear fealty to anyone. You don't have to swear fealty to a god. You don't have to swear fealty to a jarl. You don't have to swear fealty to even the community. If you want to do those things, that's wonderful. If you want to commit your path to the community or to a deity, that's wonderful, but you don't have to do it. And I'm really worried that these public rituals, these public oath ring ceremonies, are really giving a bad image to what this faith really is about. There is no swearing fealty if you don't want to. There is no oath if you don't want to. You're not the president of the United States. You don't need to swear an oath of office when you start this path. You don't need an oath ring when you start it. All right, so I have built into your head, if you've made it this far in the video, this is what I'm worried about. This is what I'm trying to fight. If you are starting this path, you don't need this. You do not need oaths. Just know that if you do choose to swear an oath, that how important and sacred it is. And you better be really prepared for what is coming and what are the consequences if you do not fulfill that oath. Now, what I've been recommending to people, if you want to swear an oath of fealty, of service to a god, you know, you really want to make sure you're getting benefit from it. And that's the thing that a lot of people come into this. They're like, oh, I want to swear an oath to Odin. Okay, what are you doing? And they're just like, I just want to swear an oath to him. It's like, what are you getting out of this arrangement? I have a very, very laid out specific thing with Odin. And so if you want to swear an oath to Odin, just be prepared for what are you getting out of this arrangement. Just don't do it blindly. Ah, man, I tell you, once again, I just struggle talking about this subject because I don't think everyone should do this. And if you want to do it, just be prepared. That's all I'm trying to say. But it can be as simple as just putting your arm on here in front of a sacred tree or a sacred spot with an offering of mead and talking to that deity. Explain exactly what you want to do, why you are swearing an oath to them, and what you hope to get out of it. But also have that offering nearby to give as a gift to show that. The last time I swore an oath onto here, it was very personal. It was very private. It was just my own home. I didn't record it. It was one of the few things I don't record of this journey because it felt that special, which is the other reason why I don't believe in public oath ring ceremonies. If you want to invite a few close friends and family close by when you do it for them to bear witness, that's great. I've had people come up to me at gatherings and they're like, hey, can I swear an oath with you later? Of course, that's fine. But as far as these big display public ones, I don't believe in them. Just because, it sends the wrong message, and I believe these are very private and intimate affairs. So, I know I've gotten a little rambly in this and maybe a little bit of just like, but at the same time, I really, really just want you to make the right decision on this path. I really want you to understand that this path does not require an oath, that this path does not need an oath ring, and that if you just want to wear this as jewelry, good on you, that's great. They look really cool, I love wearing it. But as far as like a sacred ritual object, I say it is not necessary, but if you do it, just be very aware and prepared for what's to come. My life has taken so many dramatic turns ever since I got my oath to Odin, but it's made so many turns in the right way. But also, I just know that I can't ever, you don't want to say like I'm trapped in this, but at the same time, if you're swearing an oath, just be ready. It could be a lifelong commitment. All right, I am done with this ramble. I am done beating this into you. I think I've done all I can to make sure that you make the right decision, that you're as well informed as possible about these very complicated yet so common things within this faith. So, folk, until the hall, skull.